Well, I've got some really good news this morning. I have not come to endorse a political candidate. Somebody say amen. Amen. I have not come this morning to endorse a political party. I have not come this morning to talk about politics at all. Somebody say amen. Amen. I'm going to talk about Jesus. Amen. Amen. That's what I'm going to talk about. Oh, and also, where Kyle and Courtney and Henry's here, little Henry. Where'd Kyle go? Okay. Oh. Well, let's say hi to Kyle. Kyle, how old is Kyle now? Henry. 6 weeks old. I know how old Kyle is. Good to have you all with us today. All right. Hebrews chapter 13. Have y'all been seeing on the internet where they got all these preachers, you know, talking about who you ought to vote for if you're really a Christian and all that kind of nonsense? It's bizarre. And the reason why is right here in Hebrews 13, or part of the reason why, I want to start reading at verse number 8, okay? And I want to ask you to join with me as we read, I believe, about through verse number 15. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. Y'all stand up. And I might do a little comment along the way through the reading, so y'all take a deep breath, okay? Verse 8. Hebrews 13, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. All right, that word Christ, that's a Greek word that is our Hebrew word, Messiah. A lot of people don't realize that. So every time you see Jesus Christ, you're seeing really Jesus, Messiah. And that word Messiah, that's a great, great, great big word and idea and really dream of the Old Testament was the Messiah. The Hebrew words pronounced something like Mashiach. And it literally means anointed, anointed. The Messiah is the anointed one. So kind of keep that in mind. So every time you see that word Christ, we're talking about the Messiah. All right? Verse number 8. Jesus Christ, Jesus Messiah is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Don't be led astray by various kinds of strange teachings. For it is good for the heart to be established by grace and not by foods, since those involved in them have not benefited. Now, part of the issue going on that the writer is speaking to is that the old Judaizers, this conflict between the old established Judaism and the new fledgling growing church, there's a lot of conflict, controversy between the two, and a lot of it was over the Old Testament regulations, rules, laws, and dietary laws. The old established Judaism said, you know, you got to follow the Old Testament dietary laws. And the Apostle Paul, with the movement of the New Testament, the New Covenant, said, you know, if God made it, it's good. Amen. Receive it with thanksgiving. So that's a lot of the issue going on there. Don't be led by strange teachings. It's good for the heart to be established by grace, not by keeping a dietary law, foods, since those involved in them have not benefited. No one ever got saved because they didn't eat pork, amen? And the other side of the coin is no one's going to get thrown to hell because they did eat pork. Thank God for bacon, amen? Verse 10. I got an amen out of that. Did you hear that? It's the best amen I've gotten in 6 months. Okay, 10. We have an altar. Now see, it's contrasting the food stuff here. Verse 10. We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle do not have a right to eat. Ooh, that's some pretty heavy stuff he's laying down. Amen. For the bodies, verse 11, the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the Holy of Holies by the high priest as a sin offering are burned outside the camp. Now here's what would happen. They'd bring in the sacrificial lamb, The high priest would take the life of the lamb. They would collect the blood. They would take the blood into the Holy of Holies one time a year on the Day of Atonement, and they would sprinkle the blood around and all that. And then the priest would also keep the best meat for themselves. Amen. And then with the rest of the carcass, the old carcass. You see, before the priest would take the life of the lamb, they would put their hand on the head of the lamb. And you know what they were doing when they would lay their hand on the head of the lamb? They would, it would be kind of symbolic, we would say. They were putting the sins of Israel, the whole nation, commuting upon that lamb the sins of the people. Okay? So after they cut the throat, drained the blood, took the blood in, then that old carcass that was left was considered defiled, unholy, and unclean. And they would take that carcass outside the walls of Jerusalem, and there was a burn pit, or kind of like a city dump, and they would throw that old defiled, desecrated carcass on that burning pit. How many of y'all ever lived in a city that had an old burn pit, a dump that always had smoke smoldering up out of it? Anybody? I know over in Fort Smith we had one, amen. That was where we always threw the opponents we beat on Friday night into the amen, coach. We need one over there by Mom L, amen. Coach Shook's getting ready to get him, I can tell. All right. The bodies, verse 11, the bodies of those animals whose blood's brought into the Holy of Holies by the high priest as a sin offering are burned outside the camp. They didn't put them in the walls, it was outside there. Verse 12, therefore, Jesus also suffered outside the gate. And so the stark picture that the writer is drawing here is our Lord was considered as some defiled, unholy, desecrated thing. They wouldn't even kill him inside the walls. They took him out there to a trash heap to kill our Lord Jesus. It's a pretty vivid picture that they all understood. Verse 12, therefore Jesus also suffered outside the gate so that he might sanctify the people by his own blood. Look at verse 13. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing his disgrace. Verse 14. For here we do not have an enduring city, King James, continuing city. We have here no continuing city. Instead, we seek one to come. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning in the name of our Lord Jesus, our Messiah, heaven's anointed one. And I pray that we'll hear within our hearts. I pray each of us. I pray for myself. Oh God, help me hear the truth of your word. That we don't have here a continuing city. We don't have here an enduring city. Lord, help us to hear in our hearts. Father, help me to hear in my heart. Help us to know. Help me to know what it means to truly come to the place in my life that I'm seeking after what is to come. That I'm seeking after what is to come. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. Israel spent a lot of time longing for the coming of the Anointed One, a long time longing for the coming of Messiah. In the whole history, in the entire history of Israel, I mean for 3,000 years, up to this very day, Israel's longed for a Messiah. Israel often found herself fraught with enemies. enemies from outside the walls, the perimeter, the borders of Jerusalem, and as many times, if not more oftentimes than not, enemies from within the border, her own people. Israel, in the entire history of Israel as a nation, she only had some 40 to 50 years as a united monarchy, partly under Saul, part of the time under King David, and the rest of the time to this very day, Israel's been divided, been scattered, smothered and covered, so to speak, and to this day is longing for a Messiah. We see this spirit of this longing. We see the hunger, this yearning for this anointed one, starting at verse number 1 of Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is on me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. There's that word anointing. That's the Mashiach, the Hebrew. This is the ministry of the Messiah, the anointed one. Look at what this anointed one's going to do. To bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, freedom to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of our God's vengeance. You know, a lot of people have a problem with that last phrase about the day of our God's vengeance. When you understand the broken hearts and the captivity, all those things that we see beforehand, God's vengeance is administered against those that would captivate, those that would hurt, those that would bruise, those that would destroy. The vengeance of God, let me tell you something about the vengeance of God. It's a glorious thing. It's a glorious thing. All right? To comfort all who mourn. Verse 3, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, festive oil instead of mourning, and splendid clothes instead of despair. And they will be called righteous trees. And he goes on. The anointed one. There was a longing. There was a hunger. There was a desire for this anointed one to set the captives free. In the 8th chapter of Luke's gospel, we have Jesus doing a lot of cool stuff, really great stuff. He's just being Jesus, amen? And he's out on the Sea of Galilee. He's in a boat with some disciples, and a storm comes up. And they're afraid they're going to sink, you know, and he does the peace be still, and the waves lay down and lap his feet. And they get to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and they come to a region there, of the Gadarenes. And there they're met. The disciples in Christ are met by a tormented man. We typically call him the demoniac of Gadara. The demoniac, the Gadarene. When I think about this Gadarene, you know, we don't know anything about his background. We're not told anything about what had happened in his life that brought him to this wretched, miserable place and condition that he was in, that he was filled by evil spirits of craziness, possessed. But we know one thing, that when he sees Jesus afar off, whatever was going on, whatever torture, whatever torment, whatever conflict was going on between the man and these demonic forces in him, the man saw Jesus and went running to him and fell at his feet. And whenever he fell at his feet, it's almost like the demons then took over and realized, what do we have to do with you? Have you come to torture us, to torment us before our time? I thought a lot about that man. We often give that man, you know, a really hard time, but I don't know what happened to him. I don't know what choices that he had made in his life that brought him to this miserable, wretched place. I don't know. I don't know if they were choices that he had made, and I don't know if there were things that had been done to him. Abuse, torture. I don't know. I don't know. But I know one thing, we all have to be careful. You know, a lot of times when Satan comes to us, you know, he never comes to us as he really is. He never, you know, he never shows up as a demon with horns, you know, and a forked tongue and arrow on the end of his tail. He doesn't show up like that. You know how Satan shows up? He shows up in a nice, beautifully packed package with ribbons and, you know, like Christmas presents. Did you hear about that? About, I think it was 50 years ago, something like that. The trash collectors in New York City went on strike. Did y'all hear about that? I want to tell you what. When Mary and I were there in August, there's a lot of trash in New York City. That was one of the things that amazed us as much as anything in New York City. As we'd walk out from the hotel we were at, we were right down, you know, near the central part of Times Square and all that. And at 9 o'clock at night, like whenever we'd get back to the hotel, in front of that hotel, there was a mountain of trash. And sometime during the night, the trash guys would come by and pick it up. And it was like that all over the whole city. At nighttime, there were mountains of trash. Well, they went on strike somewhere in the 60s. And those mountains of trash were piling up. One lady got a really bright idea. She started wrapping her trash as Christmas boxes. And she put them in the back seat of her car with the doors unlocked. And whenever she'd go out there in the next morning, the trash was gone. I've had some folks had a big surprise when they opened up that package and it was just full of garbage, amen. I thought about that a lot. I mean, I read that in the Weekly Reader. Y'all remember Weekly Reader from school? It was in the Weekly Reader back in the 60s, long time ago. And I thought, you know, that lady, she must have got that idea from the devil. Because you know what he does with his garbage? He wraps it up in real pretty packages. Oh, it looks good, doesn't it? You've known, and I've known, the people that have taken those beautifully wrapped packages and opened them up to find destruction, death, despair, heartache, heartbreak. I don't know if the man had opened up a beautiful package, or I don't know if this was stuff that had been done to him. We've seen that too, amen. Oh, did you, if you have time, listen to the radio program today, 1 o'clock on 99.5 FM or 96.5 FM, either Faith Talk or The Answer, one of those two. Because last week it ended today, a week ago today, a nationwide sting by the FBI, nationwide against human traffickers. They were arrested by the thousands last week in the United States of America. As women and girls were rescued off the streets by the hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds this past week. You know what? God's moving to set people free. The Messiah, the anointed one, is at work. And you know, a lot of those that have been hurt and used and abused, they've been wounded. They've been wounded. I don't know what this man's story, I don't know if he had opened the package or if someone had done it to him. But I know one thing, when the man saw Jesus, he ran to him and fell at his feet. And you know what? Jesus set him free. Jesus set him free. He was longing, he was looking for something, and Jesus rescued him from the power of sin. Jesus, as Messiah, has the power to rescue us from the power of sin. Has anybody here ever been rescued from the power of sin? Amen? Praise the Lord. Anybody here ever been wounded and hurt? And had God heal a broken heart? He has the power. All right, turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. We had this verse last week. Want to repeat it today. First of all, there's the longing for the Messiah, the anointed one. And then there's the revealing of the Messiah. I mean, Jesus showed up. Amen. He came. He didn't just sit in heaven. Gordon Jensen did a song way back in the 70s. Not from his distant heaven, but he came to us. Amen. I'll never forget, I heard a lady back in the 80s, late 80s, early 80s, I think we were in West Memphis, Arkansas, and she had been a pimp. She prostituted women out. And she had this crazy Christian man that would come to her house of prostitution and would try to witness to her and to the ladies there. Of course, they would mock him, ready to kick him out. One day, he went in there, and he, same guy, comes in, wanted to talk to the ladies, wanted to witness to them, share Christ with them, and they were going to kick him out. And he said, well, can I use the restroom? So he goes in the restroom, and he takes the roll of toilet paper that's on the toilet paper roll. Can you talk about toilet paper in church? He unrolls some of the toilet paper, and he takes a gospel tract, and he puts it in the roll and rolls it back up so that the next person that went in there, when they unrolled it, this gospel tract would fall out. This was a dedicated dude, amen? And this lady, the pimp lady, followed. She was the next one to go in the restroom, and she started to unroll some of it, and this gospel tract fell out. Now, she's telling this to, it was a youth thing. Maybe we're in Memphis, because there were hundreds and hundreds there. She unrolls that roll, this gospel tract falls out, she picks it up, and it broke her heart. It broke her heart that this man was going to this length, and she gave her life to Christ. And then after she shared that testimony, she sang the song, "He Came to Me." When I could not come to where he was, he came to me. Let me tell you what, in Matthew 1:21, Jesus showed up. He came to us. He didn't just sit in heaven. And you know what kind of a world he came into? He came into a world that needed a Messiah. He came into a world that was filled with heartache and brokenness and captivity and enslavement. He came into a world that was fractured, relationships, people. He came here. You know why? Because he is the anointed one. He's the Messiah. This demonic man falls at his feet. Jesus set him free. He wants to stay with him. He wants to stay with Jesus. And Jesus said, no, you go tell people what great things God's done for you. Amen. He came. He has the power to free us from sin. And this point is, he has the power to free us from the penalty of sin. Jesus Christ will save them, Matthew 1:21, from their sin. Now, there was a vice principal of a middle school, not here in the state of Arkansas. I think it was in Ohio. And this lady, she was the vice principal of middle school, and she wrote this letter. I read this letter last week where she said, you know, I thought I'd seen about everything, you know, in the schools. And said one day an eighth grade girl came in to see her, and her name's Stephanie, the girl's name's Stephanie, and Stephanie said, somebody stolen money out of my billfold. Stole my billfold out of my purse and stole my money. And the vice principal asked her if she knew who it was. She said, yes, I was told it was Dustin in my homeroom class. And so the vice principal calls in Dustin and asked Dustin if he had taken Stephanie's money. Now, Dustin was a young man. He had come from a difficult family. The mom and dad were no longer husband and wife, and he had been living with his mother, and he had gotten to the place where she couldn't control him anymore, so she had sent him to the father. So he's kind of new in the school under his father's care now. And Dustin, when the vice principal asked if he had taken the money, he said, I didn't take it. Well, then Stephanie said, I had three friends tell me that he took it. And so the vice principal went and got three friends and brought them in. The friends said, we saw you take the billfold. And then Dustin said, well, I took the billfold, but I took it in the bathroom. I didn't take the money. I just looked in it to see what was in it. Well, that didn't go very far. And so the vice principal said, I want you to give the money back to Stephanie. And Dustin said, I don't have the money. And so the vice principal said, okay, I'm going to call your father and talk to your father. And so, and if you don't get, the vice principal said, being a very kind vice principal said, I'm going to give you a week to get the money back to Stephanie. Because he was also an athlete, and he was a really good athlete coach, and he looked like he could be a star. And the vice principal said, I'm going to give you a week to bring the money back. And if you don't bring it back, I'm going to put you on suspension. You can't be involved in sports. You know, the consequences are going to happen. Well, the vice principal started calling the phone number that Dustin gave, and there was never an answer. Called several times. Finally, in the evening, the vice principal called the father's number again, and a voice answered, and he told the story, and the father said, oh, thank you so much. I'll make sure he gets it back. Got a week. Okay, very good. All right. I was like that. Well, a week goes by. Money doesn't happen. So the vice principal calls in Dustin again. Dustin, I'm going to have to put you on suspension. Dustin says, no, please don't do that. Vice principal says, okay, I'm going to call your father, and I'm going to tell him you hadn't brought the money. So the vice principal called the father's number again, and immediately an answer, but it wasn't the same voice. And the vice principal said, are you Dustin's dad? Yeah, the vice principal says, well, how come he doesn't have the money here? The dad says, I don't know what you're talking about. Then the vice principal realizes the one he had talked to the week before was Dustin. Dustin answered the phone and tried to sound like his father. The father had no idea what was going on. So the vice principal explains that. Dad says, I'll be there in 5 minutes. So 5 minutes later, father walks in. Vice principal has Stephanie and Dustin. Dad hands Dustin a sealed envelope with $23. And says, you give this envelope to Stephanie and you tell her you're sorry. Dustin snatches the envelope, you know, kind of irritated, and grits his teeth and narrows his eyes down and hands the envelope to Stephanie and said, I'm sorry. Wasn't real convincing, amen. And Stephanie did something totally unexpected. She was sitting down, and she looked up, and she smiled at Dustin, and she said, Dustin, I forgive you. I forgive you. And that was all she said. It blew Dustin's mind. As a matter of fact, as the story goes on, it was a turning point in his life. And he went through the vice principal's dad. He got counseling, he got help, and his life, he became a star athlete in the school. But that moment when that Stephanie looked up, I forgive you, changed his life. You know, my brother and sister in Christ, when Jesus looks at us, as guilty as we are, amen, or as hurt as we've been, whichever side the package has been wrapped in, whether it was choices we made or choices done to us, Jesus Christ saves us from the power of sin, and he also can save us from the penalty of sin. He's the anointed one. He's the Messiah. And then last point, John chapter 14. Gospel of John chapter 14. Jesus Christ ultimately is going to save us from the presence of sin. Okay, John 14, verse number 1. And we all know these verses very well. Your heart must not be, John 14:1. Your heart must not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places, many mansions. If it were not so, I'd tell you, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. If I go away and prepare a place for you, I'll come back to receive you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. And I've shared this with you before, how this is marriage talk. This is wedding talk. Jesus Christ is the groom. The church is the bride. He came here. He paid the bride price on Calvary with his life. And now then, Christ and the church, we are married. We're espoused. He's gone back, preparing the dwelling place. And one day when he gets ready, you know what? He's coming back. We got to go to a wedding last night. Mary and I got to, yesterday evening, up in Conway, Arkansas. Ariel Schaffler, used to be Schaffler, and David got married. Rogers, David Rogers. Did I get that name right? You know, they've been engaged for a while. How many of y'all are married or have been married? Raise your hand. It's not a trick question. Okay. How many of y'all ever were engaged before you got married? How many of y'all, when you were in the engagement time, were content staying just engaged? How many of y'all, once you got engaged, wanted to get married? Amen? And you look forward to the day you got married. Amen? How many of y'all prepared to get married? You know, prepared for the service itself, getting a place ready to stay, all those kind of things. How many of you actively prepared to get married after you're engaged because you really wanted to get married? Amen? Raise your hands. If you didn't, I know a divorce lawyer that would like to talk to you. Amen? Now let me ask you this question. Serious question. I've been asking myself this question. Trying to get ready for today. Am I looking forward to heaven with the same kind of looking forward to that I look forward to marrying my wife, Mary? And do I have the same kind of preparation? Am I as actively involved in preparing myself, looking forward to that time that we meet the Lord together? I mean, really now, where do I spend, I'm asking myself, why do I spend my time working toward, preparing for, more than I look forward to the time to meet Christ? As a matter of fact, as I think about it, in my life, and a lot of times even with Christians I've met, it's almost like, I want to go to heaven, but I'm not ready to jump on the ship yet. You know, it's like, I believe, and when I die sometime, you know, I do want to go to heaven, but you ever feel like we're kind of, our affection, that our heart is kind of torn between two worlds? I've really been convicted getting ready for the message today that I think heaven needs to have a little bit more of my interest, my heart, my thought, my plans, my time. What do you think? I think so. I'm talking about Chuck. Let's bow for a word of prayer. How about you? Let's ask yourself that question. How about you? You know, a part of that also, as I've lived long enough to know that death is real. I've lived long enough to know that every one of us knows how to die. I've lived long enough to know that you may not know, I may not know when I will die. I've lived long enough to know I may not live long enough to walk out of this auditorium this morning. I know that. I'm going to die. How much time do I really in my heart long for that day, that time, that event, that encounter? Because I know it's going to happen. Of all the things I think I know that's going to happen. If you're here this morning without Christ, you know, I don't know how to put it in a pretty wrapped package. I really don't. But I know one thing. I know you're going to die. I know that. I've seen that. And I know if you wait till that. To receive the Messiah, the anointing of Jesus, the forgiveness of sin, the remittance of the penalty of sin, then I know you've waited too long. I know that. Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of Jesus. And Lord, for all of us believers, Lord, help us to get our priorities where you would have our priorities. And I don't know how to write a program to get that done right. I don't know how to write a 10-week Bible study to make my priorities in line with yours. But I know it's got to start with your Spirit pricking our heart, pricking my heart to want that with you. Do that, Father, with us for your name's sake. And then, Lord, I don't know who's here this morning listening. I don't know who might be listening on the internet right now. Anywhere in the world, someone might be listening. Somewhere in the world, this whole world might be listening. That needs the Messiah, that needs the Anointed One to break the power of sin, to forgive the penalty of sin, and to help us to look forward to being free from the presence of sin with you. Lord, speak to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Michael, let's all stand. And whatever the Lord says to you, do that today. Do that today.
Higher, be lifted higher. Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of